Hey, this is Mixing Night. Thanks for joining me. I'm Ken Lewis. I've got a great show for you guys tonight. It's been a great work week for me, and I'm super excited to show you guys some really ridiculous modifications I made to the SSL. You might be able to spot some of them right now. You'll be seeing those in a few moments in all their glory. When I sprint mix Lahzarus Sacred Circles, I'm going to start the show sprint mixing that. And finally, it's available for sale at myaudioschoolonline.com. Let me just show you that real quick. Boom. There you go. Sprint Mix Sacred Circles right there. I finally have some stuff for you guys. Okay. We just relaunched Audio School Online this week. I'm going to be showing you guys a quick walkthrough of it. But let's see. What's going on this broadcast? I had some great pre-submitted questions this week. For the future broadcasts, get your questions in early. We go through these days in advance, and we really try and put together a great show in advance and then take questions off the chat roll as well. So if you're active on the chat roll tonight, you know, light us up with questions, be active, be respectful. What have I been working on? Harlore. So the group that we're developing, Harlore, we signed an incubator deal with them. The first single finally comes out next month. It just went off to mastering today. I'm super excited about it. I'll play you a little snippet of that later on in the show. It's a song called Not Ready to Go. So I think it comes out October 29th. So we're super excited about that. It's going to be great. Let's see, tons of Q&A tonight. I have a lot of DAW examples. I'm showing mix bus stuff. I'm showing a lot of vocal stuff, vocal chain, EQ, stereo monoizing, session prep. It's going to be action-packed. Let's see. Oh, we have Marcus Manderson, Mixing Night Man of Mystery, to bring you another great segment on free DAWs. So he's going to drop you all the greatest free shit on this episode again. If you haven't caught Marcus on the previous episodes, don't miss him. He's great. So again, if you are just tuning in, I'm Ken Lewis. This is Mixing Night. If you haven't yet, please subscribe to the YouTube channel. There's lots of great content. We're putting new videos out every week. Shout out to my Discord community. I'm giving a Sonox Elite bundle away to the Discord community live tonight on air. So somebody who is a member of that 1,000-plus strong and building community is going to win a Sonox bundle tonight. That's going to be awesome. Oh, we got over 4,000 subscribers on the YouTube channel. So hey, if you're watching free right now and you haven't dropped me a subscription, just, you know, click that button and maybe set your reminders for next week's show so you don't forget. Same time every 2 weeks. Every other Wednesday, 8 to 10 p.m. New York City time. What else has been going on? My career has been on fire lately. Recent mixes for Columbia, Island Records, another unnamed international supergroup. Currently working on music right now for a legendary rapper that I've worked with many times before. You know who that is. Oh, hopefully that will be coming out soon. My production partner is Brent Colatallo. We are the production team Catalyst. We produce for Kanye, Kendrick Lamar, Future, Ingrid Michaelson, J. Cole, One Republic. We just did that incubator deal with our new artist Harlore, so you're going to be hearing a lot from Harlore coming up. And before I do the sprint mix, many of you know of my love and appreciation for art and unique things. And I met an artist named Joseph Tobia recently, and I really loved his work. And we came up with a concept to modify the SSL. So, Lori, if you can show the overhead camera, you can see I modified the SSL. I took away the entire frame that comes with it and had a brand new frame built around the entire thing. But that's not the coolest part. The coolest part is this. Come on now. Oh yeah. So this is called Shatter Art. See if you can get a good look at this. And it's hardwood and epoxy, and he, I don't know how the hell he does this, but he builds it up over layers, over days of time, putting all of this together. He made molds of my original console pieces, the side pieces, the top piece, and the front piece. He made molds of those so that he could resize and repurpose them, and then found hardwood and epoxy that fit those molds, and then we ran lights through the whole thing, so... I'd say this is probably a one of one. I've never seen anybody do this. And, you know, for my two cents, your workspace should be inspiring to you, especially if you're a creative making music in the music industry. I keep finding ways to be inspired all over again. This is certainly another way for me. All right, I'm gonna keep the lights going and sprint mix. Boom, here we go. All right, Sprint Mixing Sacred Circles by Lahzarus. It's available right now at audioschoolonline.com. Sprint mixing, in case you don't know, there are six different levels. I'm doing the top level, which is the Jedi level. I have 10 minutes on the clock, and I'm faders down to a complete finished mix in 10 minutes. here we go. And this is about 30 stems, so I have approximately 20 seconds per stem to make a final decision on where every single track of this song goes to be my finished mix. Now, why sprint mixing? This is a great way to build your instincts and your speed and your gut and your skills. It's just the fastest way to improve your mixing that you could possibly come up with. So 10 minutes on the clock, let's go. Sacred Circles, Lahzarus, available at Audio School Online.
Crushing us now and again. Take all the space and time you need. You really think that you waste and find if you find the universe can't stop it. I just reward. Show me your sacred circle. See if you can find a clue, the question or the answer to the forces pushing out and in. Are crushing us now and again. Just reward. Show me your sacred.
4 minutes in and everything is in the mix just about. I might be missing one vocal and it's starting to come together. Now I can work on my fine tuning. And now that everything's in the mix, I'm just going to start tweaking away. All right, back to it.
I'll see if you can find a clue, the question or the answer to the four. DNA inside your veins, the fruit of life, it must remain the key to all the things that are and were. Start to drag our feet along the path instead of finding out what's up ahead. So look before you leave, else you may find yourself among the next. Well, show me. It's in the DNA inside your veins, the fruit of life, it must.
I'm just going through and fine-tuning everything right now.
Remarkable, impossibly impossible. There's no such thing as you inside.
Of course. Well, that was my undoing. Let me see if it'll come back quickly. Probably not. Oh, man. Let's see. Well, all right. I still got a minute left. Let me see if I can salvage this shit. This is the real world, baby. You never give up. You got a client sitting right next to you and everything falls apart. Can't break a sweat. You just gotta pretend that you know exactly what you're doing and then start figuring out what the fuck to do as fast as humanly possible. And if enough of my mixes come back, I might be all right. I probably won't be because I only got 44 seconds, but I think that's probably it for the sprint mixing. I swear the mix was going to be great. Well, let's find out. Okay. Nah, I ended up losing a lot of it. All right, well, you know it would have been a great mix. We all know. We all know. All right, on to the rest of the show. There's the console. How are you guys liking the console? All right, here's the broadcast lights. Woo! Okay. On with the show. Let's see. We're going to go into some... Let's go into some Q&A. Why not? Okay. Oh, you know, I'm gonna, while I have your attention, let me just give you a quick run through on the new Audio School Online. So the song that I just sprint mixed was Sacred Circles. And if you go to Audio School Online, you can find this tutorial. Here's what comes with it. It's got 6 levels. I just did level 6, the Jedi level. And then it's also got the marathon session, which is basically the entire raw session from scratch that I did the original full, like, 6 or 7 hour mix on. So you get all levels plus the marathon. You can compare your mix to mine. If you're mixing on the Jedi level and you're making it sound good, you're fucking with me. So, you know, there's where the bar is set for you. Let's see. What else is going on with... I'll show you more on Audio School Online in a bit. I want to get to some Q&A first. But the other thing, you know, I do these videos that shows you basically, you know, how...
Hey, it's Ken. Well...
You know, that's me. All right, let's get to Q&A. I'm going to show you guys the site in a little bit. Super proud of it. Okay. On to Q&A. Nora asks, hey, Ken. Hey, Nora. What is your favorite album of all time? Here's a few. I don't know if I have a singular favorite. Prince Purple Rain seemed to tick all of the boxes. It's probably not the one I would listen to the most, but there's just something about that album that's just really special. Toad the Wet Sprocket, Fear, great album. Live, Throwing Copper, Alanis Morissette, Jagged Little Pill. Elton John, Yellow Brick Road, Goodbye Yellow Brick Road. There's a bunch of them for you. You know, I didn't really get introduced to hip-hop until I got to New York City in 1993. And I started, basically, if you were in New York City working in 1993, you either were working on hip-hop or you were not working, which is basically it. And I didn't really know a lot about hip-hop when I first got to New York. I just kind of learned on the fly. And, but that was my education. My education in hip hop was learning from, you know, the fucking elite people who were both producing and the artists, at the time as a staff engineer. And, you know, I racked up a ton of experience and credits and chops, and that's how I learned the craft, getting taught by, the super heavyweights. So that was, but my earlier years was all rock and roll. And now it's a whole lot of rock and roll coming back at me. Let's see. Nicholas Puga asks, hey, Ken, thanks for having your audio toots. Been a fan since 2012. Having said that, thank you, Nicholas. Having said that, I've seen you deal with many genres very successfully in your videos, pop, indie rock, hip hop, EDM. My question would be, what is your advice to keep the aesthetic integrity of each genre when you have a production that clearly has a crossover? And you know, like rock and trap or some shit like that. So, basically, I think the best thing I can tell you is, for instance, if it's a song that I think we know is going to go to radio. If it's a rock trap song, is it going to go to rock radio or hip-hop urban radio? If it's going to go to urban radio, I'm going to make it a little more bass heavy. If it's going to go to rock radio, it's still going to be bass heavy, but it's going to be a bit more guitar driven than it would be in the urban thing. So I try to think of what speaks most about who the artist is, and then what speaks most about what the song is trying to say, and just do your best, you know. I think that, you know, everything is its own challenge, but those are some guidelines. Nate asks, hey Ken, if you get stereo drum stems, kick, snare, had, etc., do you sum them to mono or mix them as bounced from the producer in stereo? Okay. All right, I'm going to show you two things, because I get stems in all the time from all over the world to mix. Boom. Come on. And when they come in, they need to be... Okay, so here, let me back up. Here's the big problem. When a lot of times when you have a stem, it's a stereo stem. It has a left and a right. But the sound coming out of it is dead center, mono. It only needs one track. So why is it on two tracks? And if it is on two tracks, it's then taking up double the space, double the processing power, double the plugins, all of that stuff. So before I start mixing, I strip all of my stereo tracks that are actually mono down to mono. And let me show you how to do that. So one of my favorite ways is this program called Stereo Monoizer. And let me find it here first. Boom. Okay, so this is Stereo Monoizer. And all you got to do is drag and drop. So I'm going to highlight these stems. Oh, come on. There we go. And I'm just going to drop my stems onto Stereo Monoizer. And I'm just going to hit Analyze. And it's going to seek through. And it's going to tell me. Here we go. Here's some. Everything starting out was no conversion. Then we start hitting stereo files that need to be converted to mono. So here's one, mono left, no conversion. Here's more mono. So this goes through and tells you what is mono and what is actually stereo. And then you can process it and overwrite or save it as new files, whatever you want to do. And then it just goes through and processes the entire thing for you. And now you have a smaller folder with only the file sizes that you need. All the mono files are mono. All the stereo files are stereo. Your mix is less cluttered. Your processing is less taxed. And all is right with the world. Now, if you don't have Stereo Monoizer, I'll give you one other way to do the exact same thing. So I threw a bunch of the stems that I just stereo monoized. I'd also thrown them into this Pro Tools session. And, you know, no big deal. So we're going to look at these three kick tracks right here. Okay, so first. Third. Okay, now across the mix bus, I have set up this Waves S1 stereo imager. It's currently bypassed. But when it's not bypassed, I have the phase inverted on only one side, and I have it set to mono. See, the width goes in to zero. So it's basically like taking the pan pots and putting the pan pots in the center and flipping one side out of phase. This is called A minus B listening. And anything that doesn't have a stereo component will completely disappear in A minus B listening. So those three kicks that are all, you can see, stereo tracks, left, right, left, right, left, right. Those three kicks will start bypassed. And when I unbypass this, you might be able to hear just the very, very, very faintest sound of a completely inconsequential. All three of those are dead mono. Each of them is taking up two tracks needlessly. So if you're a Pro Tools user, then you just go into Pro Tools and you highlight those three and you hold Control and you go under Split into Mono. And then you just get rid of the stereo and half of the one of the two mono files, and what you're left with is three mono kick drums. There you go. So those are all still playing. I'm just, they're canceling each other out because now they're all in mono. And if you see as I play, you can see they're canceling because if I pan, you hear it come back. But in the center, it cancels. Okay, so that's two different ways to check your stereo mono stuff. That stereo monoizer is like $50. It's a great little plugin, and it's made by Blake Eisman, who's one of us, basically, mixer, producer. Okay, Thomas asks, well, I might get into this later. Can you explain a bit about the Plugin Alliance Black Box? And Shane also asks, can you shed some light on Mixbus EQ and how you make your high end across all elements feel cohesive? I can show you a little bit. Let me just pull up that Sacred Circles mix that I was hacking my way through, and I'll show you. By the way, when you download your level after you've purchased, it comes like this. You'll see all six levels. This is level six. It's got all different templates. So I just go to my Pro Tools template, and you can see where I started. There you go. Okay. So typically, when I start a mix, I will start it with an EQ across the mix bus. And usually, the one that I'm using is... this one. Yep, here we go. So I'll usually start my mix like this. 14K boosted and 1700 boosted a little bit. And just a little bit. And what this does for me is it allows me to EQ less on each individual channel. And it's just... You're probably going to need that high end anyway. So I just find it just helps kind of get your mix together faster. And then the other thing, that Blackbox HG2, I usually add that near the end. And for this is usually the one I just check and see how it sounds, Rock Anarchy. And I usually just dial back the air amount for however much I need. It starts pretty severe. You add a lot of top end, and it's kind of an aggressive setting. But this tends to be the one, and if I don't like it, then I'll scroll through presets until I find something I do, or I'll just get rid of it. And, you know, the key with anything is just to use your ears and, use some common sense and not try and mix with your eyes. Not try and do things just because you think you should be doing them instead of because you hear something that's telling you to do that specific thing. Okay, from the chat roll, Trana Fitness asks, is there a separate sub-kick and kick channel in Sacred Circles? No. It's just... That sounds to me like a trigger kick layered with a live kick. I can't remember. I'd have to pull up the marathon session in order to tell you for certain. But I don't think there's a sub-kick in there. There might be. I don't think there is, though. But I'll layer... You know, sub kicks, no problem. The Mac Space is a great plugin for adding that component if you don't have it. What else is good? Submarine sometimes works, a little gimmicky. Let's see. All right. What do I got coming up? That's a packed show tonight. We got Marcus Manderson coming up in a little bit. I'm going to get to the Mixing Night Man of Mystery. Sorry for the coffee slurp. Love these mugs. All right, who's on the chat roll? You're welcome, Trana Fitness. David Stedman asks, from the chat roll, hey Ken, have you ever flipped the polarity on the drum bus or vocal bus as a method to ensure their protrusion? I don't know what the word protrusion means. Got a pretty good vocabulary, but that's not one of them. I'm assuming you just want to check the phase. If anybody missed the video that we put out on Sunday morning or Sunday afternoon, it was all about phase coherency. Let me pull it up for you, just to show you, because this will be the very... here we go. Are your drums too weak? So the real title of this is checking phase coherency on drums. Everything you ever wanted to know is going to be right there. I've shown some of that stuff on the show. It's really fascinating. But basically, I check my phase coherency at the beginning of any mix. Anytime I have two one-shot drums hitting together, like two kicks that hit together, or two snares that hit together, anytime I have a kick and an 808, I check phase coherency. And anytime I have two microphones capturing the same sound, stereo overheads on a drum kit, stereo piano, stereo guitar, whatever it is, microphones, live microphones capturing this one single sound source, you got to check the phase. Let's see. Tommy Driscoll asks, hey Ken, I have trouble mixing bass and kick to stand out in the mix. Apart from sidechain compression and slowing the attack of the bass, what tips do you have for this? Thanks. Tommy, you know, that's tough because obviously it's always frequency dependent on what you're given. But typically if I have a kick and a bass that are fighting, I try and stack the frequencies kind of like, like that. So I find the fundamental of the kick and I'll bring that out, and I'll find the snap of the kick and I'll bring that out, and I'll scoop areas that I want the bass to live in. And I may find wherever I've boosted the kick drum, say it's right here, I'm going to cut just a little bit on the bass right there to let the kick breathe a little bit there better. You know, not too much. These are small things. And just, you know, I usually try and stack it so either the bass is below the kick or the kick is below the bass in energy. Not in there, all the frequencies are going to mix, but in energy, where you're placing the energy down there. And then you make sure that where the note comes out on the bass, which is usually around 1K or 800, is a nice spot for that. You're not trying to fight with the kick drum right there as well. So it's kind of like, you know, keys. Sound Strategy from the chat roll asks, hey Ken, do you align your drum close mics to the overheads or to the room mics or vice versa? Are your drums too weak? I show all of that stuff, but I think there's basically two ways to do it. There is, you pick one drum and you align everything to that drum. So I could align everything to, say, the snare drum. The kick aligns to the snare. The left overhead aligns to the snare. The right overhead aligns to the snare. The hi-hat aligns to the snare. Or you can do it kind of in series, because I like when my stereo overheads are phase corrected with themselves, much more importantly than with the snare drum, usually. So often I'll do snare as the master, the kick looks at the snare, the left overhead looks at the snare, the right overhead looks at the left overhead, and then the hat usually looks at whatever overhead it's under. So if it's under the left overhead and the hat's right here, then the hat is going to look at the left overhead for alignment as well. So you have all of these kind of things that are trying to find their best place. And the other thing about phase alignment is it doesn't always work. You know, just because you have a phase alignment plugin and you hit, you know, analyze, and it looks at it and it spits out a number, and you listen and you go, okay, well, that's not better. You know, those things happen. These are not exact sciences, and it's kind of like with eyeglasses. It's a real better or worse type of thing with phase. The other thing with phase, if you're not super up on it, is it can often be very subtle. Sometimes it's super, super noticeable, but sometimes a change in phase can be really subtle, but man, you pile those subtleties up over the course of an entire mix, and then you really have something. Let's see. Shaolin plugin box. Where am I at? Jake Thundershield asks, I love that name, Jake Thundershield. What was your biggest motivation to pursue music full time? Jake Thundershield, working shit jobs was my biggest motivation. And the most notable was when I was in, I think it was my college job, might have been my after high school college job during the summers. I'd come home and work at Allied Van Lines Moving Company, and my job 6 days a week all summer, usually 10 to 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, was to move people in and out of their houses in the sweltering heat and humidity all summer for 2 summers. And the thing about that was that, it was just gruelingly hard work for very little money. But a lot of the guys that I worked with, that was their job for life. And I'm not knocking them. Those guys worked their asses off. But I don't want to do that for my life. I want to make records. And I realized that if I didn't bust my ass in the music industry, that I wasn't going to have this career that I have. And I think that Allied Van Lines mover job was probably the best job that I ever had in my life. Because, man, I never want to do that again. Man, that is just insanely hard work. I much prefer sitting behind a console and making music all day, every day. Okay, Fight a Kite Music, I like that name too. Fight a Kite Music asks from the chat roll, hey Ken, how does EQ and compression after phase alignment affect the phase relationships you have established? Usually, your plugins, your DAW is supposed to auto-correct for that shit. But often it doesn't. So sometimes if I'm hearing problems after the phase correction, what I'll do is I will make sure that my plugins match from, so I can't really, where's my overheads? Oh, they're already combined. So for instance, if I had these two guitars right here, and I wanted to keep them in phase, I would just make sure that whatever plugin series I had on the left side was also matched on the right side. And if I wasn't doing any EQ on this, I would still leave it instantiated, but I would just leave it there with no, don't bypass it, because then, you know. So the long and short of it is your two things that you want to keep in phase, I find that even though you shouldn't have to, sometimes you have to keep the same plugin chain on both, just for timing. Okay. Let's see. But I also think you're probably asking, like, not from a numbers relationship, just how to, you know. Correcting phase is going to help you do all of those things. So when you find that you have something that's slightly to vary out of phase, then you phase correct it. It's much easier to EQ, much easier to compress, much easier to find a place for it in your mix, all of these things. I shouldn't say much. A little bit easier to a lot easier. Depends on how much your phase is fucked up. Let's see. Coffee time. From the chat roll, Ethan Dodgen asks, hey Ken, do you have a favorite mix? Of my own. Let's see. The Dawn Penn No 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 mix that I did in 1993, I fucking love. It's Dawn Penn No 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 remix. Old shit. I played that on the show once. Love that mix. Scrizzly Adams, Me and You, I produced that as well. Danity Kane Damaged was one of my favorite mixes. Oh man, the Wu-Tang Secret album that hopefully you guys will get to hear at some point. I love those mixes because they were just so raw, and it was like the biggest challenge mixing the Secret Wu-Tang album was not fucking it up and not doing too much. The, you know, wanting to add things and wanting to use your tech to improve the sound on that record was not the move at all. And that was a real challenge mentally, to figure out how to get the mix finished and feeling great without doing too much to it. And again, that really, you know what saved my ass was my sprint mixes. Because sprint mixes teach you balances. And the number one key, most important thing about the Wu-Tang album was getting the right balances. So there you go. Let's see. Ethan asks a follow-up. Hey, Ken, how long have you had your mixing console? I got this in 2007, and it's still a workhorse. It has very low maintenance. The great thing about the SSL AWS is it's super powerful, and it has the very classic SSL sound. The EQs are, I think, better than the 9K EQs. We've got a couple of compressors, but you plug it into the wall. I mean, four of us carried this upstairs. And just took the legs off, carried it up a flight of stairs, and put the legs on and plugged it into the wall, and you're done. And you don't need, you know, extra AC towers and all of that shit. Let's see. I'm going to go to Marcus Manderson in a moment, but I'll take a couple more questions before I do that. Len F. asks, hey, Ken, is there a mix that you thought was the best mix ever, and after it was released, you realized you missed or you could have done something different, and what was that track? Let me think about that. I don't know. I don't know. I tend to like my mixes. So, if I thought it was the best mix ever, I probably thought it was when it came out, too. You know, that's the thing. A lot of people, like, struggle with finishing your work or knowing when it's done or just being able to call something finished and walk away from it and be okay with that. And I think there was a long struggle for me for a long time. There was a struggle for me for a long time with knowing when something was finished and being able to live with it. But I don't have those problems anymore. And I think that's more mental than anything. It's mental and it's experience. It's getting enough experience that you know when you've nailed it. And you know, let the chips fall. The Down On Me mix actually was unmastered. It went to CD and radio straight from here. No mastering at all. Let's see. Eric Torres, I'm going to go Eric Torres. I'm going to get to your question in a minute. For now, I'm going to get to Marcus Manderson, Mixing Night Man of Mystery. Marcus does these great sections. He does these great segments for us, finding all of the best free stuff. And this week, Marcus has found us the best free DAWs. So take it away, Marcus.
What's good, everyone? This is Marcus Manderson, aka The Fingers, Mixing Night Man of Mystery, and this episode is all about free digital audio workstations, or DAW. So let's get right into it. First, we have this Nintendo Entertainment System music editor called FamiStudio or FamiStudio. I haven't used it, but you can look at the website here by BlueBlue. Another new one, MPC Beats, has been out for a couple of weeks now, but it's based on the MPC platform that's been out for several decades now by Akai. They released this free DAW MPC Beats. Definitely check them out, MPC Beats, on their website. Audacity is another free DAW, not fully featured because it doesn't allow you to import MIDI, but you can import audio. You can do some quick audio mixes. Very powerful platform, and it is free. And you can also get different skins, as you can see on the graphic there. Definitely check out Audacity if you just need to do some really lightweight audio editing, audio mixing. Next, we have Waveform Free by Traction. Again, a free platform. You see some of the colors and graphics there. Check them out. See if that platform could be useful for your workflow and see if you can use it for your production and mixing. And the next few will be popular or the most popular DAWs that you might see out in the world that have either free or light versions. And we'll start with Ableton. So they have Live Light. The current version is Live 10 Light. You can use Live 10 Light fully featured for that light version, for your productions, for your mixing. You can go to the website and see what you get in the light version. Next, we have Cubase LE by Steinberg, which is a light version of Cubase. Again, you can look on the page there. It's like one of those limitations, up to 16 audio tracks and 24 MIDI tracks, which is really all you might need for, you know, a quality song. But again, look at the light version, see how it compares to the full version as far as pricing and features. But again, it's free. Next, we have Pro Tools First, which is the free version of Pro Tools, called Pro Tools First. And there it is there. You can see it on the left there. And then you can get a free trial for some of the higher end versions for Pro Tools or Pro Tools Ultimate. But Pro Tools First is a light edition of Pro Tools where you also have limited track counts and limited features. But again, it is free and fully functional. Next, we have Reaper, which is not fully free. It is a free trial. So you get, I believe, 60 days for free where you can use Reaper. And then after the 60 days, you can buy it if you like it so much. And next, we have Studio One. Prime, make sure it is Prime. Prime is the free version of Studio One. Unlimited time to use that, but limited features again. So limited from the Studio One artist and full series. But Studio One 5 Prime, again, you have limited features, but it is great for what you want to do. If you want to do some production and mixing and just want to get your feet wet with the Presonus or PreSonus. I don't know how you say it, but PreSonus, Presonus. But if you want to get your feet wet with the Studio One platform, try Studio One Prime. Current version is version 5. And last but not least, we have Apple's Logic Pro. Apple Logic Pro is not free, but you can get a 90-day free trial. That used to be, I believe, 30 days. And because of COVID-19, they extended it to 90 days. So you can currently get it for 90 days, free trial. And then after that, it is $200 or $199 to purchase. And then, of course, on YouTube, for any of these platforms, if you just YouTube, type in the name of the DAW and the tutorial, and you can get some more information about those. Again, this is a list of just some free DAWs out there on the market. They are included on the free list in the Discord app that I have supplied. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out. If I missed any, definitely let me know. We can add those to the list as well. More being added every day, and also some are being taken away. Some are merging with other companies, so always be on the lookout for some of those new platforms or merged platforms. Again, thank you. This has been another Mixing Night Meta Mystery. Be safe and be well, everyone. All right, peace.
All right. Thank you again, Marcus Manderson, Mixing Night Man of Mystery. Love his segments. Always brings the great free stuff. Now, Marcus mentioned, in case you missed it, I have a Discord community, Mixing Night. I shouldn't say I have a community. We all of us have a community at Discord Mixing Night, started by Rory Miller and Dominic Ravinius, and well over 1,000 people now. I post there all the time. I read a lot of the exchanges. It's becoming a really great place for exchange of knowledge and ideas and critiquing and listening and you know, and sharing. And I'm really super stoked at the way the Discord community is going. So if you haven't checked it out and you're looking for, you know, a good place like a Gear Sluts without all the fucking drama, check out my Mixing Night Discord. Love Gear Sluts, but I can't post there 3 times without getting fucking savaged by some 16-year-old keyboard warrior in his bedroom. So, enough of that. Let's go back to some Q&A. Let's see. Kevin Lassiter asks, Hey, Kevin. Ken, what is the purpose of printing your mix to Pro Tools, and is that something a Logic user should also do? Yes, you should print back into... Well, no, you can bounce. Whatever works for you, offline bouncing. Okay, here is... I can't show you on the screen because it'll feed back, but like I did last week. Oh. Okay, here is my mix routing. Whenever I do a mix, starts in Pro Tools. Every single thing that you hear in Pro Tools hits the SSL somewhere, either one of the first 24 channels right here, or one of the 8 echo return channels over here. And I will, if I don't have enough faders, I'll combine things in the box. Usually, like background vocals get combined, any real similar things, guitars, you know, synths, whatever, second sound effects, a lot of those. And, you know, I may have 20 tracks of sound effects. All of those will come out 2 tracks on the SSL. and I'll do most of the adjustment and the mixing in the box. And with the SSL, I will take the key things that I want individual control over, kick, snare, lead vocal, bass, guitar, 808, you know, piano, whatever the main elements are, and I'll try and get those on individual channels on the SSL, and then I'll try and group everything else into stereo groups elsewhere on the SSL. And then if, I don't know if you can see this from above, but you see I have two lights on here. These feed the mix bus. So the green light feeds the main mix bus, and the red light feeds the second mix bus. So if you're familiar with like what Michael Brauer does by mixing into three different mix buses, this is kind of similar to that. You can do that with this. And you can see, why was I telling you that? I can't. So I can assign to either of the mix buses. Usually the majority of my mix stays on the main green mix bus, and occasionally I may put something onto the red bus to EQ it differently, to subgroup it differently, to not compress it when I want to compress the rest of the mix. There's a whole lot of reasons why I might do that. And then those two mix buses go back into Pro Tools on aux returns, aux inputs. And that aux input is the only thing in my Pro Tools session that feeds the master fader. So none of the source individual tracks or effects or any of those goes straight to the Pro Tools master fader. They all go through the SSL, then back into auxes into the SSL, and then to the master fader. And then if I want to add mastering or, you know, finishing work on the master fader, I can do that within Pro Tools. So I can put outboard gear across the master here if I want. And usually the Sontek EQ and or the Manly Verimy lives across the mix bus here. I can assign them to IOs within my session and use them just like a plugin, but you only get one. But yeah, that's basically it. Everything goes Pro Tools into the SSL, out of the SSL, back into Pro Tools, and the only thing that I'm ever listening to the entire time is the end of my mix bus chain. So I'm not hearing anything until it's left Pro Tools, going through the SSL, going back into Pro Tools, hit the master fader, gone through my plugin chain, then out the speakers. That's when I hear it. So I know that every single change that I make has hit all of my converters, has hit every single piece in the signal chain that can degrade it some way, that can, you know, whatever. And I'm hearing exactly the changes that I'm making and what their end result is. So that's basically what I do for signal flow. I have a UAD Apollo. So my main interfaces are Avid Analog 16s. But I have a UAD Apollo that I run my hardware analog inserts with. So I have an Apollo 16. And I have the ability to run 8 stereo, 16 ins and outs. And I'll put everything on those. And then in Pro Tools, it's just like adding a plugin. IO13 is my Manly Verimu. IO12 is my Lang PEQ2. IO11 is my Sontek Mastering EQ. You get the idea. And those are your inserting an analog piece of gear into your digital signal chain. So, and I think this is what a lot of guys like Serban and Phil Tan and people like that do. They don't mix on a console, but they do use outboard gear. And the way they use it is on inserts with their interfaces. And then you got to recall it by hand. But usually, the way I use outboard here, I usually use it for a very specific sound that it gives me, and I usually don't touch it. So I only use it if and when I need that sound from that box. And if I change it, I just take a recall of it or take a picture of it, and that's it. Okay, let's go to the chat roll. Let's lighten up. Idro asks, "Hey Ken, what artist was the hardest to mix? What artist was the hardest mix to do in your career?" I've had some monstrous BTS mixes. Jesus. The great thing about BTS mixes, I think I've done 36 or 37 of them by now. I've been mixing for them since their very first album. They flew over to mix with me. But their track counts can be when I get an only 150 track mix from BTS, I'm rejoicing. That's like a small mix for me. And it's not, the good thing about their stuff is they're very well recorded and organized and produced, but I've gotten sessions with 200 tracks that are just, you know, I think the worst is when you have a producer who never rough mixed it well enough to know what they had and just piled on way too much shit and then just expect you as a mixer to sort it out. So, yeah, that's always the worst. Justin Gleason from the chat roll asks, hey, Ken, what's on your master bus? There's a few things. Typically, Manly Varimu, either the Sontek outboard EQ or the IK approximation of it. Depending on if I'm mixing on the console or in the box, I'm on any given day, usually I'll have the Pultec Pro Legacy across the mix bus. It's one of my favorite plug-in EQs, the UAD Pultec Pro Legacy. What else is on the mix bus? The Plug-in Alliance BX Digital V3, I usually use that for anything surgical and a little bit of widening. For finishing, I usually will finish with Fab Filter L2, Pro L2, or Slate FGX, or Ozone 8. I don't have Ozone 9 yet. Or Ozone 8. Those are the three that I tend to gravitate towards most if I'm doing some finishing work. All right. Lars Mayer asks from the chat roll, hey Ken, what do you use for a digital to analog converter to get into your SSL and back out? It's just the Avid Analog 16s. That's all it is. I'm not running any like super high-end clocking or super high-end converters. When I got the Analog 16s, I had read a ton of reviews from people that I trusted, and they all raved about it. So I was like, okay. So, you know, I don't really get caught up in like the extra 0.5% of anything that, you know, 96K sample rate gets you or slightly better converters get you. I mean, I'm not into that stuff because I've got great gear. So I'm not into that stuff anymore because I think I basically have it solved enough that anything else is going to be a really expensive update for a very little sonic boost. And you got to have a lot of extra cash laying around to spend money like that on things you don't really need. So, all right. Eric Torres asks, hey Ken, how can you ensure RMS levels will be right in the mixing stage? Eric, the first key is starting your mix off right, and that's gain staging. And when I start my mix, I wish you could have been in here when I was doing the Sacred Circle sprint mix, because I start my mix on 11. So the volume knob is all the way up. Faders are down. You got to make certain that you're not running any automation or anything that's going to snap up and blow your ears and your speakers out. But if you start your volume all the way up, then your faders end up being like down here for your balances. You know, your kick is going to hit at this volume instead of at this volume, if that makes any kind of sense to you. So if your kick hits at minus 30 instead of minus 5, that probably means you have preserved 25 dB of headroom on your mix bus. So it's not going to end up working out that good, but, you know, but that's how you basically leave yourself a lot of headroom in your mix bus. And then as you get closer and closer to finishing your mix, you start finishing your master fader and doing your finishing work on the master until you're to the point where you want to, you know, all of your balances are all together. Not much of anything is going to change. And then you can do your final mix bus work. That's typically how mine goes. Let's see. Ooh, ear training's coming up soon, but we'll hit a few more questions. Let me go. Let's see, Ethan Dodgen. Hey, I'll get to you in a second, Ethan, on the chat roll. I wanted to go back to, here. Jai Sandlo asks, hey Ken, being a 99-time, art gold record winner with all of the caliber artists you've worked with as an engineer, how do you deal with an artist hovering in your ear on all the little details they want done in your mix. Okay, so Jai is basically asking, you know, why do artists got to be all so impatient? I typically don't have artists in the room with me while I'm mixing. Sometimes I have them listening in on audio movers remotely if they want to. But typically, I'm like, I don't like anybody to hear anything until I'm ready to present it. And I think most mixers are like that. And I don't want them, because along the way, every time they hear me do something, they're going to judge what I'm doing in the moment. And I'm playing chess and they're playing checkers. And I'm sure this is the problem that you've run into a lot. And you just got to keep reminding them that they're playing checkers and you're playing chess. The things that you're hearing now are you're formulating a strategy in your brain of what they are going to sound like as your mix evolves. So don't let the artist in the room. Don't let, you know, if they have to be, at least, you know, give them some boundaries or let them know those things. Good luck with that. I know it's a pain in the ass. All right. Ethan Dodgene from the chat roll asks, hey, Ken, what is your opinion on the Audio-Technica ATM40 headphones? My opinion is I have never used them, and I have no opinion on things that I have never used. So there you go. Master Blaster from the chat roll asks, hey, Ken, do you ever mix on a single monitor speaker like an Auratone? No. I check mono compatibility, but I don't really concern myself super much with like super mono compatibility. I basically can listen to my stereo speakers and have a pretty good idea of how it's going to translate to mono. That's just years and years of experience for me. For you, I don't know, you should check. All right. Mike Heebs asks, hey, Ken, THC or CBD? Can't wait for another mixing night. Gonna be epic. Mike Heebs, so I will qualify that answer by saying I have a medical card, which I desperately need. I haven't spent too many moments of my adult life not in some level of pain. So the medical card for me is pain relief, which THC is great for. Here's the one thing that I will tell you about marijuana. I didn't start using it until I was like 39. Not once ever in my entire life until I was 39 years old. And now it's daily, all the time. Mostly medically for pain and management and, you know. When I was a young person, I could not have controlled it. I would have used it too much. It would have been distracting. I don't think I would be here right now, because it just, the great and terrible thing about it is it makes you give no fucks. So if you're, that's why it's great for anxiety. If you're anxious, to have some pot, it gives you no fucks. But if you need to work hard, it's harder to work. Actually, for me, I find it mostly really easy to work when I'm high. Mostly because I use so much pot that I don't really get high anymore. So that's kind of the thing. Things you didn't know before you started using. Let's see. Paul Hinton asks, hey, Ken, you mentioned that the music biz is a small community. It most certainly is, Paul. How do you deal with someone who is seeking collaboration with you, but you don't feel it's a good fit? They might have a slow, lazy work ethic or dishonest. Even when a good amount of money is offered, do you bite the bullet and take the gig if your gut says it's a bad idea? Paul, you know, this is a tough one to answer because everybody is in a different place in their life and their career and their survival. Man, sometimes you just need the fucking money and that's that. And if you need the money and that's that, take the money and do the work and that's that. But I will say that don't ever take a gig that you're not willing to put in 100% into. So if you're only taking it for the money and you're just going to be like, you know, I mean, I can do it. I can get by. It'll be okay. I can kind of, you know, get through it. Don't take that gig, you know, because somebody worked really hard to earn that money to pay you. So, you know, respect that money that they worked to earn to pay you. And the fact that they're willing to pay you to, you know, do something creative, make sure you always do your best work. And I certainly always try, whether it's, you know, I'm mixing or producing for a super indie that nobody's ever heard of, or Kanye. It's all that everybody gets the same treatment. Let's see. Oh, okay. Nick Bisciotti asks, hey, Ken, how do you record session horns? Okay, so there's a couple things to address here. There's, are you only recording one horn or a horn section? So let's start with a horn section. If I'm recording a horn section, let's take that plaque on the wall for the middle eight for New Day. And I told the story live on one of the mixing nights, but basically I got called at noon to produce a horn section for a Kanye Jay-Z record for Watch the Throne, and I needed to have it finished and delivered in Manhattan by 7 p.m. that night in person, and it was noon, and I did it. And so, and you can go and listen to it on Watch the Throne. It's the bridge horn section. So when I set up horns, this microphone in front of me, this type of a microphone is very often really key, or at least the polar pattern that it has, which is a figure eight. So this is a ribbon microphone, okay? Ribbon microphones here, it's, have you ever seen the figure eight on a microphone polar pattern? Okay, what that means is it hears equally out the front towards me and out the back towards my console. If I went around to the back and was talking into the back of the microphone, it's just as loud and just as clear as if I'm talking into the front of the microphone. And if you did that with, a large diaphragm condenser, something like this, I don't have my C800 with me today, but a large diaphragm condenser, if you spoke into it and then you spoke into the back, if it was on a cardioid, you would sound like you're in a hallway down the hall or something. So, okay, so figure eight polar pattern, that's a natural polar pattern with a ribbon. Large diaphragm condensers, some will do that polar pattern, so I'll use those as well. But the reason that I picked that polar pattern is I want the, so if I have four horn players in a row, say 3 or 4 feet apart across the room, and a microphone's in front of each one of them, I want that microphone to hear as much of the player in front of them as possible and as little as possible of the players to their left and right. And those horns are just feet away. You can imagine how loud they are in the room. But with this microphone, watch, listen to the rejection characteristics. I'm going to talk squarely into it, and then I'm going to go over to the side, and I'm going to talk into the side, and you'll see just exactly how much side rejection this polar pattern has. I practically disappear. So if I'm talking, I'm talking, I'm talking, I'm talking, all of a sudden I am really, really far away. That's because the microphone is at full rejection right now. And as I come back around, it just warms right back up and gets full again. That, so if you notice, that's rejecting the sides out here. It's not hearing anything out here. It's only hearing this. So if I have four of these lined up in front of four players or four figure eight mics, then I can really capture that player very well and the side players very minimally. Now, if I'm only recording a single horn player, it depends on what kind of horn. I produced the horn section on all of the lights for Kanye West. That was all done here. Danny Flam played the majority of the horns on it for me. And when we set Danny up, I have pictures of this somewhere. I got to find them. We set Danny up in the other room with his, he must have brought like 30 horns. So check out newyorkbrass.com if you ever need horn sections. My God, he's incredible. So he brought like 20 or 30 horns. We just had them, strewn all over the place. And we would have the C800 and a ribbon. I think the Royer R122 was the ribbon of choice that day. And I think a third microphone. I can't remember what I used for a third microphone as a room mic, just like across the room capturing. But the ribbon and the C800 were both usually wherever the sweet spot is on the horn, which is different for each horn. If it's a trombone, I'm usually, and the bell of the trombone is right here, I'm usually like typically horns, I'll catch the side of the bell, not straight on. It's too loud, it's too piercing, it's too much wind coming through, but just off to the side is where all of the color starts coming out and all of the character of the horn usually starts coming out. And maybe a foot or three back, you don't have to be super close, especially if you're only recording one instrument and not, you know, a full section. All right. What has 9, 10? Oh man, we are so close to ear training. Are you guys ready? I don't think you guys are ready for ear training tonight. I know that ear training 2 weeks ago was a real bitch. I would have struggled with that. I hope you guys are really enjoying these things, because it's a lot to put together, but I always try to come up with something that you haven't thought of yet. So this one's going to be on levels. So all different things from solo instruments and hearing to what level they change, to hearing a single instrument or vocal in a full mix and hearing it change within the full mix and hearing what the change is. That's going to be fun. 5-10 minutes, I'm going to get started on that. God damn, we have a great crowd tonight. Thank you so much for showing up. And the chat roll's been on fire tonight. So I think in order to get on the chat roll, I think you need to have your own YouTube channel. You don't have to post any videos up. You don't have to have any actual presence. They force you to create your own channel, and then you can get on the chat roll. So if you're not on the chat roll and you want to know how come not, that's why. And please get on there. This is a really great group of people. A lot of them are on the Discord community. It's been awesome. Okay. Do I want to show that? I'm going to do ear training first, and then I'm going to show some Layla Blue stuff that I mixed for Island Records. That's going to come up next, and then I'm going to show some Scrizzly Adams vocal, like high-frequency taming stuff. Okay. But right now, I'm going to ear training. So, you may have downloaded the ear training worksheet, off of your email if you got it, or from, I don't know, wherever you get that. Dominic, tell them where they get it. I have no idea. And after the ear training, I'm going to do the Sonox Elite Bundle giveaway to the Discord community. So stick around for that. Man. Let's see. What did I want to show? Oh, yeah, I'm going to do the ear training. You know, it's hard to keep shit straight around here. Get some more coffee. That'll fix everything. Okay. Ear training. This is spot the volume changes. So I'm going to play a sound. You're going to have to pay attention to the screen a little bit. Yellow is the source unchanged. And red is the volume changed piece. So you're listening for what changes from yellow to red. Change back to yellow, etc. And then sometimes you'll see sometimes you'll see a green piece, like right there. Those are just I'm playing the individual instrument first so you can hear it within the full mix. Because there will be things that only change one instrument in the full mix. Okay. So grab your worksheets. Let's get started. Number one is a breakbeat. What is the volume change on the breakbeat? Here we go. All right, you getting the hang of it so far? Okay, the next one is a güiro percussion. I'm sure that's not the exact pronunciation of it, but, you know, I'm one. All right, how much is the güiro changing and in which direction? That's the other thing. You gotta figure out, is the volume changing up or down, and how much? So 1 dB, 2 dB, 6 dB, 3 dB, what is it? So, And, you know, let me just talk for a second about how this helps you. being able to perceive how much something changes in volume is going to help you as a mixer greatly. It shocks me the number of times that I just pull up a fader and within moments I have it sitting exactly where I need it, because it's all this balancing thing. So if, and part of the ability to balance is being able to hear the differences between a dB and a half a dB and what that changes and how it changes the feel and things like that. So number two, Guero. All right, number three, congas. Number four, claps. I'm not trying to make this easy on you. Number five, lead vocal. So the red is where the lead vocal changes. And this is a pretty compressed vocal, so the changes are pretty even across the board.
I put my faith in you, grinded and made it through all for the glory and none for the gold. I pray you make it to your destination through all of your obstacles, don't ever fall. I know the stories ain't all that they telling you, I know some more they just never been told. I got a hand it to Satan, she find me wherever I go. Yeah, yeah.
How many dB did that change? That is a rapper Goat Blood out of Texas. This is a song called Diablo that I produced for him. All right, number six is piano intro. So this green part, I'm going to play you the... Here, hang on. Okay, so that's what you're hearing, and you're going to hear that part change in the mix every time it goes red. Next one is a breakbeat change in the mix. I'm going to play the breakbeat, and then I'll play the full mix. And the only thing in the full mix changing is the breakbeat. Number seven. Number eight is lead vocal. So the green is just the example of what you're going to be listening to in the full mix.
I put my faith in Diablo.
Grinded and made it through all for the glory and love for the goal. I pray you make it to your destination through all of your obstacles. Don't ever fall. I know the stories ain't all that they telling you. I know some more they just never been told. I got a hand it to Satan. She find me wherever I go.
Did I tell you that was the lead vocal? This is the lead vocal. I'm going to play it one more time.
I pray you make it to your destination through all of your obstacles. Don't ever fall. I know the stories ain't all that they telling you. I know some more they just never been told. I got a hand it to Satan. She find me wherever I go. Yeah, yeah.
Nice. All right. Number nine. I have taken one line, one lyric, and looped it. So the first loop is unadjusted, the second loop is changed. So again, this is vocals. You're only hearing the vocal changes to the mix.
I know it's something inside me that push me and pull me to places it want me to be.
Nice, nice. All right. One more lyric, same kind of setup, majority silent line. This is number 10.
Vision the room is divided, majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regret. Vision the room is divided, majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regret. Vision the room is divided, majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regret. Vision the room is divided, majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regret. Vision the room is divided, majority silent, they waiting. You gon' regret. The room is divided, majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regret.
All right, and number 11, the Niapa, we got congas for you. Full mix, only the congas are changing. How much did the congas change? All right, you got your answers. How did you all do? All right, let's go back to the top. All right, the very first breakbeat is up 6 dB. Up 6 dB. Nice. The Guiro, number 2, down 4 dB. Down 4. Down 4 dB. Number 3, congas, is down 5 dB. Claps are up 1 dB. Vocal, lead vocal, is up 2 dB.
I put my faith in you, grinded and made it through all for the glory and none for the gold. I pray you make it to your destination through all of your obstacles, don't ever fall. I know the stories ain't all that they telling you, I know some more they just never been told. I got a hand it to Satan, she find me wherever I go. Yeah, yeah.
Number 6 is the piano intro, and the piano jumps 6 dB. Next is the breakbeat, and it's up 4 dB.
I put my faith in Diablo. Yes, I'm the shit where to find you. I'll be wasting time on you. I'll be wasting time on you.
Up 4 dB. Number 8. lead vocal against the music, the lead vocal is up 2 dB.
Destination through all of your obstacles, don't ever fall. I know the stories ain't all that they telling you. I know some more they just never been told. I got a hand to say, and she find me wherever I go. Yeah, yeah.
Nice. The push-pull vocal is up 2 dB.
Something inside me that push me and pull me to places it want me to be.
Lead vocals 2 dB up. The majority silent, number 10, is down 1 dB. Lead vocal red is down 1 dB.
Silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regression, the room is divided. Majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regression, the room is divided. Majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regression, the room is divided. Majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regression, the room is divided. Majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regression, the room is divided. Majority silent, they waiting to see.
And finally, number 11, instrumental with congas. The congas are up 6 dB. And I'm going to put the key on the screen one more time so you guys can triple check your answers. The congas are up 6 dB. How did you all do? If you're on the chat roll, let's see how everybody did. I know that's really hard. You know, if you're not used to mixing every day, it's just tough to hear those little 1, 2 dB changes. You know, feels like it's more or less, or like you can't even hear what's happening. And that perception just comes with more listening time, you know? I won't chew ice in your ears. Not yet, anyway. Give me time. Give me time. All right, I don't need that anymore. Okay. What else is on the show? Ear training is finished. Ah, the Sonox giveaway. All right. So, we started a Sonox Elite Bundle giveaway on my Discord Mixing Night community. This giveaway is only going to Discord members. So you have to be there and enter in order to be eligible for the contest. I'm definitely going to do more contests like this in the future. You know, anytime I can bring extra value to Mixing Night or the Discord community, I'm always going to do that. And you know, and I really have to thank everybody who has tuned into the show, and especially the people who have made this kind of a regular part of their thing. You know, I set out to build a sense of community and connection, and kind of give some back that, you know, from this career that I've had that's been really good for me. And you know, during this pandemic where we were locked inside for months, and we're probably going to be again sometime soon. And so, you know, again, out to everybody. Thank you so much for being a part of the Mixing Night broadcasts and the Mixing Night community. It really means a lot to me, and means a lot to everybody that works on the show, I can guarantee it. Speaking of people that work on the show, might as well give out some quick shout-outs. Let me show the new site. No, I'm going to do the giveaway first, then I'm going to show you the new Audio School Online. One thing at a time, step by step here. All right, Sonox giveaway. Winners. One winner. Who's it going to be? And the winner of the Sonox Elite Bundle is Andrew at Audio Grove Studios. Boom. Congratulations, Andrew at Audio Grove Studios. You won the Sonox Elite Bundle. And man, that is just an absolutely killer bundle. You're going to love that shit. You know, the Sonox bundle where it came from is the old Oxford digital mixing consoles, and I used to use one at Hit Factory in New York City all the time. And I was an early adopter of the digital mixing consoles. Neve had a Capricorn, and Sony had the Oxford, which became Sony Oxford. And it was basically the way the console looks is the way the plugins look and act and feel. And I mixed so many records on that console, man. So using those plugins for me is kind of like going home. All right, where was I? All right, we gave away the Sonox. Congratulations. Speaking of big giveaways, who has seen the Apollo giveaway? I'm giving away an Apollo X8. That thing has four mic pre's. The thing is a beast. Tons of processing power. The top of the line fucking UAD. That thing is an absolute beast. I'm giving it away in 2 weeks on October 14th. You can register for it at the, where can you? Discord community. My Instagram has a link. My Instagram is at Ken Lewis Producer. If you're not following me on Instagram, follow me on Instagram, at Ken Lewis Producer, and join the Apollo giveaway for sure. Man, somebody's going to get that. Big shout out to Fabian Ramos. So Fabian Ramos won I gave away a Distressor last show. That happened. And Fabian Ramos won it. He's in Bogota, Colombia, so it's en route to him right now. But congratulations, Fabian. I know you're going to make amazing use of it. And I've also seen, I really have to thank you. I've seen you post up the new contest for the Apollo in a couple forums and groups and stuff on Facebook and whatnot. And anybody out there who's spreading the word about Mixing Night or spreading the word about the contest and giveaways, but especially about the broadcast, like, I so super appreciate anybody who's telling their studio friends about this shit. You know, it's hard to break through the noise, and I think I'm bringing a program that's different than what anybody else is doing. But the reality of it is, if you don't tell somebody, they're probably never going to know about it. So please share the good word about it. What is next? ASL. Let me show you the new Audio School Online. I'm super happy and proud that we got this relaunch. So there's my, who doesn't know that I have a school? This is my school, audioschoolonline.com. All of the tutorials here are all completely done by me. Nobody else is on the site. If I'm showing you something in a tutorial, it is something that I use and do on a regular basis or have used on records. I don't show techniques I don't use. I don't teach things I don't know. I only teach from my strengths. And I tend to fill in the little higher end stuff that that school doesn't teach you. You know, you can certainly know that the person teaching you is reliable and telling you the right stuff. So I'm just going to give you a quick once over for the site so you can see it real quick. Those need to be updated. That's 57 and 71 and 99. Man, that 100 is elusive. All right. I'm assuming you guys are following along. There's some of my credits for those who don't yet know. I've done some things. Here's my discography if anybody wants to see really everything I've done. I have a categorized mixer, producer, writer, arranger, so it's, or you can see all credits. And you see I've done some work for some people. I wish I could bring those sessions to here, but it's a little hard to get rights. Okay, so where was I? Back to, and then, so here's what you get. Me, video tutorials, resource materials. So for instance, like this Sacred Circle Sprint Mix. So you get a couple videos with it that either, like the mixing videos will have a full, usually like a 90-minute run through or something like that, hour, 2 hours of a full mix start to finish where I walk you through step to step, step by step, every single thing that I'm doing and why. Don't be on the screen for a minute. Sorry. Let me just focus for a brief moment. Okay. Well, that's not signed. Oh, here we go. Okay. Where's my Sacred Circles? Okay, so here's Sacred Circles. So you can watch the video, and then you can go to the resources, and you have this particular lesson. You have 6 levels, from super beginner, you've never mixed anything in your life, to Jedi. That's the one I open the show with. If you can get a solid mix on Jedi level, you're fucking with me. And then the marathon session, which is the full raw session. All of these are stemmed out. This is the full raw session that all of these came from. So after you progress all through your levels of sprints, once you've conquered the Jedi level, you can go to the marathon mix and spend as long as you want mixing the marathon session, you know, 10 hours if you want. And then you can compare it to my final mix, which is in there as well. And you have an about, so it tells you all about what the lesson is. Let me just show you some tutorials so you have an idea of what's on the site. You know, I usually don't sell to you guys, but since we relaunched Audio School Online, I gotta pay for this program somehow. This shit ain't free. It's free for you. So here's some of the tutorials. Got trap mixing, drums, keyboard for beat makers is a popular one, layering drums, sprint mixing. I'm going to be dropping a ton of sprint mixing tutorials this year, so lots of stuff for you guys to practice your own sprint mixing on and challenge me. Mono stereo panning explained, EQ basics for beginners, mixing lead vocals, vocal comping. And here's the basic gist. If you think you've learned anything from me on a mixing night in these 5-minute segments that I do, imagine what I'm doing, breaking down an entire mix start to finish over the course of 2 hours, or showing you how I mix lead vocals. Like the lead vocal lesson, I take 5 separate lead vocal chains, and I mix the same lead vocal 5 different times with, like, stock, then waves, then UAD, then a smorgasbord, and then channel strips. And then I show you the results each time, and I show you the different decision making. You get it. Okay. So that's my school, Audio School Online. Check it out when you get a chance. I'm gonna show the Layla Blue stuff. Okay. So, And tell your friends about Audio School Online too. Again, this is one of those things where you kind of assume people know this stuff, but most people have no idea that my school exists at all, let alone how much information I've put out on there that's super cheap and super accessible. Okay, speaking of Fabian Ramos, who won the Distressor, he submitted a question before the broadcast. Hey Ken, what process did you use on the lead vocals of Layla Blue's song Company? Okay, so Layla Blue, Island Records, just put out a new single called Company. I just mixed it. I can't pull up the session because I don't own the rights to it, but I can pull up the video and I can pull up screen captures of my plugin chain, so that's what I'll do. So I'm going to play you the first verse, and then I'm going to show you as I'm playing what vocal chain is being used on that. And, well, here.
I with the mirror. I reach out in front, try to stop her, but it cracks. I grab the wheel, try to steer her. It's harder to breathe when I'm near her. I cover my ears, try to block her, and she laughs.
Okay, so this is the vocal chain for that. In order left to right, and then down. So, start with the Cambridge, a little bit of low frequency rumble filtering, a couple notches in the lower mids and right in the mid. Very gentle sloping boost here. Kramer Pi compressor, waves de-esser, pretty stock standard. My crossover here is 58. It's pretty low for a girl, but this was a pretty dark low vocal performance, so I didn't feel like it needed to be higher than that. Then a little bit of notchy cueing going on and a couple frequencies, nothing major. And then on to more shaping, broad shaping. This is a Pultec 10K boosted plus 5. That's the only thing I'm doing on this Pultec. And one more wideband de-esser with a notch to get all those those kind of sounds. That's what that one's for. And that's the verse. So let me play you the verse again while...
The mirror, I reach out in front, try to stop her, but it cracks. I grab the wheel, try to steer her. It's harder to breathe when I'm near her. I cover my ears, try to block her, and she laughs.
Okay. And then here's the effects chain on that. I'm only using two things. This Echo Boy is like a short slap spread vocal. It's not like a repeat delay. I'll play it for you one more time. And then a real short, you can see the decay time is set almost to completely minimum. A real short chamber I've got on her as well. I'm filtering out some of the low end and removing some of the bass, boosting some of the mids. And I'll play that. So that's this chain. I grab the wheel, try to steer it. It's harder to breathe when I'm near it. Hear that little slap is the sound choice. Okay, then we move to the chorus. Here's the chorus vocal chain. Okay, so this one, similar to start out, it started out as the same plugin chain, then I modified it from there, which is something I very commonly do. So Cambridge to start, same settings. Kramer Pi, same settings. I don't know why, but I used the Sibilance de-esser instead of the Waves de-esser on this. And then the same notches that I have in the verse. Now here, I change a little bit. I go from 10K to 12K, and I go from plus 5 to plus 6 on the high frequency. So I'm opening up the top end a little bit more in the chorus, and you see I'm cutting 3K? 4K. I'm notching out a little bit of 4K in the mids, and I'm boosting 2K in the mids, and 700 in the mids, and 100 in the lows. So I'm actually doing a lot of shaping with the pull tech in on the lead vocal in the chorus. Then it goes through the Slate virtual mix rack. What am I doing here? Just a little bit of EQ here, some compression with the... So this is basically limiting. I'm basically evening out any kind of volume discrepancies and just making it one perceived volume. And then the little bit of saturation is this New York saturator on the VMR. And then a little bit of de-essing to tame the saturator. And that is this. Okay. One more thing on Layla. Dilla O'Neill asks, hey Ken, how do you get a front to back mix? So I'm going to show you conceptually how to do that, just with the differences between how the verse affects. So here's the verse lead vocal effects chain. And here's the... Sorry. Here we go. And here's the... No. Here we go. Yep. And here's the hook lead vocal effects chain. The first two things are the same. So I'm using the Sound Toys Echo Boy and UAD Capital Chambers on both of them. Then on the hook, I'm adding three more reverbs. I'm adding a real short room that's probably got a slow attack. So it's probably like a half a second room with a slow attack to it that gives me a bit of depth. So that would stack perceptually, if you're looking front to back, how things stack up, it would be like, here's the front range is where the Sound Toys is. Then the Capital Chambers creates that second layer of depth. And then we start adding more depth layers in the chorus. We add the springs from Audio Thing, which is usually a mono spring reverb, I think, in this case. Verb Suite Classics, that's just a tight room. And then a long Valhalla Vintage Room, 4 seconds, just carrying into the abyss. And so this is a great example of, you know, almost as short, medium, you know, semi-long to super long. And I, certainly every mix doesn't need a 4-second reverb, but this shows you like some good ideas on maybe the differences in how you can set up your effects between verses and choruses, to add excitement and to kind of progress the story along. So if you have any more questions about a company, let me know. I'm not going to get to most of the rest of this. And while I'm on vocal chain, I'll do one more show. Tommy asks, do you have a go-to vocal chain? I do. Don't have it on the screen for a second. I got to find it. I don't think I put it in the main folder. Nope. Let me see if I have it over here. So I kind of, Lori did a mock-up of what my vocal chain is just so we can show it on air, but now I need to, come on, where is it? I'll find it. Maybe I won't. I don't know. Here it is. Okay. So here's my vocal chain, and I will say this, when I record vocals through this vocal chain, my vocals in my mix usually don't need much of anything at all. Certainly not EQ. Sony C800G, that's a tube condenser microphone. That's a heat sink on the back of it. The tube is in this section right here between the heat sink and the body, incidentally, in case you didn't know. Into a Groove Tubes Viper mic pre. There's 8 more tubes in that one, so we're already up to 9 tubes. The Thermionic Culture, the Phoenix. This is a very Mu compressor. I like this a lot on vocals, actually. Avid, then my interface, Avid Analog 6. Oh, and then I go into the Kush Clarophonic, brighten up the high end a little bit, and then into the Avid Analog 16. So, but even a Sony C800, I brighten it up while I'm tracking. And I find that a little too bright while you're tracking is usually perfect for the mix. So there you have it. Do I have another show to do, I think? Am I missing anything? I talked about the Apollo giveaway. Oh, here's a question from Khalib. I can show you this before I get on to my last sprint mix. And also, while I'm at it, I haven't decided what my sprint mix for the end of the night is going to be. So, does anybody want to choose for me? Here's my choices. You guys decide what I'm going to end the night sprinting with from the chat roll. Let me know what you all decide. I could do any of those. They're all going to be a challenge. Okay, Khalib? Khalib asks, hey Ken, what's the best way to tame high frequencies on a vocal but still keep it vibrant? How much do you EQ vocals, and what analog EQs do you like best? All right, there's a lot to unpack there. I'll go in reverse order. Analog EQs that I like best, certainly on vocals and other things. The Lang PEQ2 that I have, I love that thing. My Soundtech MEP250EX is like mastering level great equalizer. And my GML 2032 is fantastic. I love those three are like my three favorite EQs for almost anything. I also have these Neumann mastering EQs that came out of the old Atlantic mastering studios. So those are some of my favorite analog EQs. How much do I EQ a vocal? As much or as little as it needs. A lot of times my vocals, especially if I'm producing and have recorded the vocals, my vocals make it to the mix un-EQ'd other than how I recorded them. And the best way to tame high-end but still keep it vibrant is right here. Okay. So I'm going to show you two things, and this was recorded on my vocal chain, so it's gonna sound pretty darn good. It certainly doesn't need EQ, but I'm gonna show you how to tame the high frequencies if they were actually a problem. Here's the vocal.
Maybe the way that you're moving just shakes me alive, I see. Maybe the heat got too strong, but you can't get enough because all that you want is best left alone.
Okay, so that's Grizzly Adams, Too Close to Fire. It's the vocal sounds great. It's on that chain that I just showed you. So quality recording. The only things I have on it right now are auto-tune and Kramer Pi. And that's it. And the other thing that I would have on it is a de-esser. I have my crossover at about 6K. That's average for a male vocal. You just find the sweet spot. And let's hear what this is doing to tame. You hear that tss, that's what we're listening for, how this affects it.
Maybe the way that you move me just shakes me alive, I say. Maybe the heat just shakes me alive, I say. 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 Just shakes.
That's too much. When it starts sounding lispy is when you have overdone it with your de-esser. So be mindful of that and don't do it.
Just shakes me alive, I say. Just shakes me alive, I say.
Okay, so that's one way to do it.
Just shakes me alive, I say.
That's about 7 dB of high-end reduction. Only momentary when it sees it. In case you don't know what a de-esser is, it literally de-esses. S, T's, all of those hard S's and consonants, it helps tame those. The other plugin to do that, I'm going to bypass the de-esser, is Soothe 2. So the way I have this set up, I have it on hard detection, so all of these controls work in real time. I have the sharpness pretty sharp, so I'm looking for momentary fucked up places, usually, so you're not going to get much of the effect on this microphone because it's a great microphone, but if you're using a $100 shit microphone for a lead vocal, Soothe 2 is going to save your ass. So set the sharpness. I usually dial in 4x oversampling and ultra resolution on the lead vocal, everything to fast, and then I just dial it in until, you know, I'll show you.
Just shakes me alive, I say. 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 Just shakes me alive.
With all of these things, there's a sweet spot. They're great and terrible. You can ruin things very quickly, or you can make them sound beautiful.
Just shakes me alive, I say. 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 Just shakes me alive, I say.
That's nice. It's a real-time analyzer, so it's just doing a little bit of cleanup. All right. What did you all decide for a sprint mix? Diablo, height main. Diablo is getting some love here. Temptation, tipping point, blur. Wow, you guys want everything. Diablo keeps coming up. All right, I use Diablo for ear training, so let me see if I can use Diablo for the sprint mix as well. I fucking love that song. Uh-oh, did I just... Oh, I did. That's life. All right. Where is Diablo? Diablo Sprint. Sorry, I will find this. Sprint. Okay, here we go. I'm going to have to do some prep on this before I get it together. Thanks for joining me tonight. I had a great crowd. Geez, we still have a great crowd. Thanks for hanging out. We still have 100 people on the live on the broadcast. I appreciate that, everybody. Chat roll's been on fire tonight. All right. So I'm going to set up for Diablo Sprint Mix. Hope you guys have enjoyed the new console. Oh, it's like my new favorite thing in the entire world. Oh, boom. Oh, look at this beauty. It's so fun. You know, you got to be inspired by your environment. And when I met that artist, Joseph Tobia, I was like, this is what I need in my life. So I did it. All right. Come on, Pro Tools, you can do it. Should have never quit that. Should have never quit you, baby. All right, we got anything else from the chat roll? you guys. Let's see. What else is happening? We've been watching Money Heist on Netflix. Great show. It's actually Spanish from Spain. Really well done. It's a really captivating story about a bank robbery. And so we're in the middle of season two on that right now. Really enjoying that. Recently finished Cobra Kai. Super highly recommend Cobra Kai on Netflix. And Away on Netflix was really great as well. Oh, God. All right, let me zero this out. Is this the Sprint? No, this is four Sprint. I'm sorry, people. Oh, come on. Sorry, everyone. I don't know why I can't find this. Let me see if I can. No, that's not it. Diablo. Nope. I'm going to mix something else. Sorry. Oh, here it is. Just when I couldn't find it, it was right in front of me the entire time. At least Pro Tools is up now. See, I haven't really lost anybody. Appreciate hanging out. All right. 10 minutes on the clock. Time to mask up. Let's make sure this is zeroed out before I do anything. All right. Uh-oh. What the hell's going on? Things got minds of their own. Oh, okay. Boom. And let me get rid of any plugins, any effects. Suit, see? Suit 2 comes in handy. Kramer Pi, boom. Okay. I'm going to leave the L2 on the mix bus. Yep. All right. Without further ado, thank you for joining me, everybody. This has been Mixing Night. My name is Ken Lewis. I really appreciate you all hanging. And this is Goat Blood Diablo, produced by Catalyst. Oh, what am I doing, Ken? 10 minutes on the... There we go. 10 minutes, and boom. Good night. Yes, this is the song we used for ear training.
the glory and none for the gold. I pray you make it to your destination through all of your obstacles. Don't ever fall. I know the stories ain't all that they telling you. I know some more. They just never been told. I got a hand it to say if she find me wherever I go. Push me and bring me to places it want me to be. I know it's people who watching and want me to act like exactly what they want to see. I got the vision, the room is divided, majority silent, they waiting to see. You gon' regret ever lighting this fire, you gon' regret ever playing with me, so quit playing with me. My faith in you. I'm the Diablo.
Yes, I'm the she where the banyo. This is me completely untuned.
Sippin' Henny, fuckin' shorty, this some old three. You know I don't think what you remember me. Cause it's like I'm living fast at a slow speed. I'm 667 with a home team. I ain't beefin' with a dummy where it's OG. Nah, I don't need a home with the hoes. Sippin' Henny, fuckin' shorty, this some old three. You know everything, but you could never know me. Cause it's like I'm living fast at a slow speed. I'ma leave it in the past if it feel left. I'ma check it at the door before we proceed. My time. 7 with a home team. I ain't beefing with a dummy where it's OG. Nah, I don't need a home with the hoes need. Sippin' Henny, fuckin' shorty, this some old three. You know everything, but you can never know me. Cause it's like I'm living fast at a slow speed. I'ma leave it in the past if it feel left. I'ma check it at the door before we proceed. I need my time. 667 with a home team. I ain't beefing with a dummy where it's OG. Nah, I don't need a home with the hoes need. Sippin' Henny, fuckin' shorty, this some old three. You know everything, but you could never know me. Cause it's like I'm living fast at a slow speed. I'ma leave it in the past if it feel left. I'ma check it at the door before we proceed. I need my time with you, I can't lie, bitch. I be going crazy when we don't fuck. Swear that you be out of line, but I like it. There ain't no safety on you, you stuck. Tell me don't, when I can't.
We don't fuck around. No, 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 motherfucker. Ah, damn it. All right. Well, we'll keep the clock running. See if Pro Tools boots up any faster this time. I don't think it's gonna. Well, that's the, you know, running a live show. What can you do? I'm... I don't know, what time is it? It's 10:05. Man, I came so close on this one. I think I'm going to go ahead and wrap up the night and not keep you guys waiting forever for this thing to boot back up, because I probably lost half my mix anyway. I'm going to try and get my system tightened back up for next mixing night. And this has been Ken Lewis. Thank you for joining me. Please spread the word about mixing night. And until the next broadcast, take care. Been a great night.